Let's see about Meniere's disease. Meniere's disease is the disease of the inner ear, especially the disease of the membranous labyrinth, where the endolymphatic system is distended with excess of endolymph. This is why Meniere's disease is also called as endolymphatic hydrops. Most common presentation of Meniere's disease is vertigo, which lasts for more than 20 minutes, sensorineural hearing loss, which is fluctuating in nature, and fluctuating tinnitus, along with oral fullness. This is an image of the inner ear, in which this is the membranous labyrinth, which has three membranes: Reisner's membrane, this is tria vascularis, and the one in the base is the basilar membrane, within which is the endolymph. So all this is the endolymph present in the scala media. This is scala vestibuli, scala media, and scala tympani. So endolymph is present in the Reisner's membrane. Because of the increase in the endolymph, there is formation of hydrops. So this is called as hydrops. Leading to Meniere's disease, also called as endolymphatic hydrops. Etiology of Meniere's disease: it is either due to increase in production of endolymph or decreased absorption of the endolymph. The common etiologies are allergy, sodium and water retention, hypothyroidism, and autoimmune cause. Meniere's disease is more common in middle age, 30 to 60 years. It is more common in males than in females, and it is most commonly unilateral. So Meniere's disease can be remembered as 3 M's. M for Meniere's disease, most common in males who are middle-aged. And this is unilateral. Clinical features of Meniere's disease: as the inner ear is affected, there are both vestibular and cochlear symptoms. Vestibular symptoms are episodic vertigo, which lasts for more than 20 minutes, nausea and vomiting. And the cochlear symptoms are sensory neural hearing loss, which is fluctuating in nature, and there is fluctuating tinnitus. Also, another clinical feature is ear fullness. Coming to the signs, the signs are Tullio's phenomenon, diplacusis, and recurrent phenomenon. Tullio's phenomenon is the induction of vertigo because of loud noise. So the loud noise produces vertigo. Diplacusis is discordant sound or double sound. Here, a particular frequency of sound may appear normal in one ear, and the same appears as high pitch in the other ear. This is diplacusis. Third is recruitment phenomenon, in which the patient cannot tolerate amplification of sound. And recruitment phenomenon indicates that the disease is of cochlear origin. Let's see the Meniere's disease in a nutshell, which is also called as endolymphatic hydrops. The causes are defective absorption of the endolymph, allergy, autoimmune processes, vasomotor disturbances like stress, sodium and water retention, and hypothyroidism. And the clinical presentation of the Meniere's disease is episodic vertigo, fluctuating hearing loss, fluctuating tinnitus, and oral fullness. Examination to be done in case of Meniere's disease: in otoscopy, the tympanic membrane appears normal, and the nystagmus is seen only during acute attack. And we perform tuning fork test to detect the sensory neural hearing loss. And the results are: Rini's test is positive, that is, air conduction is more than bone conduction. Auxiliary bone conduction test is decreased, and Weber's test, it is lateralized to the better side. All this indicates there is sensory neural hearing loss. Coming to the investigation, pure tone audiometry is performed for the detection of sensory neural hearing loss. In the early stages, there is lower frequencies which are affected first, So we can see a rising type of curve. This is the curve A, which is seen in early stages of sensory neural hearing loss, which is rising type of curve. Whereas in late stages, high frequencies are also affected. Therefore, the curve becomes flat, or sometimes it can even descend down. So B and C are the curves of late stages, which is either flat or descend down. The next investigation is electrocochleography, which is the investigation of choice, and this is the most sensitive test. Here, a graph is plotted with the y-axis being microvolts and x-axis being the time in milliseconds. And there are two potentials seen, SP and AP. SP is summation potential and AP is action potential. Normally, for a normal person, the ratio between SP and AP, summation potential to that of action potential, is about 30% or 0.3. Whereas in Meniere's disease, the summation potential increases whereas the action potential remains the same. Therefore, the SP by AP ratio becomes more than 3 or more than 30%, which is diagnostic for Meniere's disease. Next is the glycerol test. Glycerol, as we all know, is an osmotic diuretic. So in glycerol test, the patient is asked to drink glycerol. Being an osmotic diuretic, there is loss of body fluids including the endolymph. So the high drops size shrinks and the symptoms improve. This is the glycerol test. Always glycerol test is combined with electrocochleography. Variants of Meniere's disease. There are four variants: cochlear high drops, vestibular high drops, drop attacks, also called as Tumarkin's otolith crisis, and Lermoy's syndrome. In cochlear high drops, there are only cochlear symptoms but no vestibular symptoms are seen. In vestibular high drops, only vestibular symptoms are seen but not cochlear symptoms. Coming to the clinical diagnosis, Meniere's disease can be classified into four types: possible Meniere's, probable Meniere's, definite Meniere's, and certain Meniere's. Certain Meniere's disease is when the histopathologic examination shows confirmed Meniere's disease. The definite Meniere's disease is when there are two or more than two episodes of vertigo along with the documented evidence of sensory neural hearing loss. Probable Meniere's is when there is one episode of vertigo lasting for more than 20 minutes with documented evidence of sensory neural hearing loss. Possible Meniere's is there is an episode of vertigo but that there is no documentation of the sensory neural hearing loss. Lastly, the treatment of Meniere's disease. First, let's see the general measures. The most important thing is to reassure the patient. And the other general measures are smoking cessation, decreasing the salt intake, and to stop the intake of coffee, tea, and alcohol to reduce the caffeine and to avoid stressful lifestyle. Next is the management of acute attack. The first step is reassurance. Next, bed rest is advised to the patient to prevent excessive movements. And IV fluids and electrolytes are excessive in amount. There is loss of fluids and electrolytes due to vomiting, so we should give IV fluids and electrolytes. Vestibular sedatives are given to relieve vertigo, which include dimenhydrinate, promethazine, and prochlorperazine, which are anti-vertigo drugs and anti-nausea drugs. Fifth is giving vasodilators. Management of chronic phase, giving vestibular sedatives like prochlorperazine, vasodilators like beta-histin, diuretics like furosemide and thiazide, elimination of allergen and hormones. And chemotherapy can be used like intratympanic gentamicin therapy, which is chemical labyrinthectomy. Here, gentamicin, which is an antibiotic, is used, which is vestibulotoxic. This is instilled intra tympanic way. So this vestibular toxic gentamicin causes destruction of the vestibular labyrinth. So the gentamicin is filled in microwick and it is placed at the round window through which it is absorbed into the membranous labyrinth. Lastly, the surgical treatment. First, conservative procedure in which hearing is preserved. First, we can do decompression of the endolymphatic sac. Next, we can create an endolymphatic shunt, a shunt between endolymphatic sac and the subarachnoid space. Third, saculotomy can be performed. Cochleosaculotomy can be performed. Fifth is neurectomy. Vestibular nerve neurectomy can be performed. Or sixth is ultrasonic destruction of the vestibular labyrinth. These are all the conservative procedures in surgical treatment. Next, destructive procedure in surgery, which includes labyrinthectomy. This is performed when hearing cannot be restored. Third is intermittent low pressure pulse therapy, called as Meniere device therapy. Intermittent positive pressures are delivered to the inner ear fluids, which brings relief to the symptoms of Meniere's disease. So there is improvement in vertigo, tinnitus, earfulness and hearing also. This is all about Meniere's disease. Thank you.